Sure. You're my new tutor? Well, nothing's wrong. You're just so tall. And I'm so tiny. Well, it's nice to meet you. Okay, well, I mean, I did come prepared. You want me to face you? Oh, I'm sorry, I'm just so shy. I'm not used to this. Usually I'm the tall one. You never did that. You're always the tall one. I can see you're quite gigantical. Okay. Well, if you say so. Alright. So, you're going to be teaching me biopsychology? Yeah, it's the 7th edition? Okay. Man. It's just so crazy. I think we should probably read just like the interesting things, okay? Like, so that way I can become comfortable and you can be comfortable with me. Because I don't know how you feel about me being so tiny compared to you. Okay? Okay, cool. Well, let's see. The case of Jimmy G, the man frozen in time. Jimmy G was a good-looking, friendly 49-year-old. He liked to talk about his school days and his experiences in the Navy, which he was able to describe in detail. Jimmy was an intelligent man with superior abilities in math and science. In fact, it was not readily apparent why he was a resident of a neurological ward. When Jimmy talked about his past, there was a hint of his problem. When he talked about his school days, he used the past tense. When he recounted his early experiences in the Navy, however, he switched to present tense. More worrisome was that he never talked about anything that happened to him after his time in the Navy. Jimmy G was tested by eminent neurologist Oliver Sacks. Do you know about Oliver Sacks? And I thought you were supposed to be the tutor. And a few simple questions revealed a curious fact. The 49-year-old patient believed that he was 19. When he was asked to describe what he saw in the mirror, Jimmy became so frantic and confused that Dr. Sachs immediately took the mirror out of the room. Returning a few minutes later, Dr. Sachs was greeted by a once again cheerful Jimmy, who acted as if he had never seen Sachs before. Indeed, even when Sachs suggested that he had met recently Jimmy, that they had met. Recently, Jimmy was certain that they had not. Then Dr. Sachs asked where Jimmy thought he was. Jimmy replied that all the beds and patients made him think that the place was a hospital, but he couldn't understand why he would be in a hospital. He was afraid that he might have admitted because he was sick, but didn't know it. Further testing confirmed what Dr. Sachs feared. Although Jimmy had a good sensory, motory, and cognitive abilities, that's thinking. He had one terrible problem. He forgot everything that was said or shown to him within a few seconds. Basically, Jimmy could not remember anything that had happened to him since his early 20s, and he was not going to remember anything that happened to him for the rest of his life. Sax was stunned by the implications of Jimmy's conditions. Jimmy G's situation was heart-wrenching. Unable to form new lasting memories, he was in fact a man frozen in time. A man without a recent past, and no prospects for a future, stuck in a continuous present lacking any context or meaning. So, basically, 51st dates. And you know, that's really crazy. Like, they didn't mention that part in 51st dates. Like, him looking into the mirror and getting really panicky because he thought he was 19, but he saw a much older version of himself. So crazy. What else can I teach you? Alright, so President Calvin Coolidge and Mrs. Grace Coolidge. Many students think that the Coolidge effect is named after a biopsychologist named Coolidge, but in fact, it was named after Calvin Coolidge, the president. And if this story isn't true, it should be. That's what it says right here. During a tour of poultry farm, Mrs. Coolidge inquired of the farmer how his farm managed to produce so many eggs with such a small number of roosters. The farmer proudly explained that his roosters performed their duties dozens of times each day. Perhaps you could point that out to Mr. Coolidge, replied the first lady in a pointedly loud voice. The president, overhearing the remark, asked the farmer, does each rooster service the same hen each time? No, replied the farmer. There are many hens for each rooster. Perhaps you could point that out to Mrs. Coolidge, replied the president.
Oh, burn.
I thought that was going to be something else, but it wasn't. Oh, okay. The case of Mr. R. The brain-damaged student who switched to architecture. Mr. R, a 21-year-old left-handed man, struck his head on the dashboard in a car accident. Prior to his accident, Mr. R was an honor student at a university. However, a year after the accident, he had become a mediocre student who had particular trouble completing his term papers. He was referred to us for neuropsychological assessment, which revealed several interesting facts. First, Mr. R was one of about one-third of left-handers whose language functions are represented in the right rather than the left hemisphere. In addition, although Mr. R had a superior IQ, his verbal memory and reading speed were only low average, which is highly unusual for a person of his intelligence and education. These deficits indicated that his right temporal lobe may have been slightly damaged in the car accident, resulting in an impairment of his language skills. On the basis of neuropsychological investigation, we were able to recommend vocation to Mr. R. That did not require superior verbal memory skills, and he's currently studying architecture. That's interesting. Neuropsychology is the study of psychological effects of brain damage in human patients. Let me see. Oof. No, I already told you what cognitive was. So tell me the definition of cognition.
Tutor.
Term that generally refers to higher intellectual processes such as thought, memory, attention, and complex perceptual processes. Let's see. Ooh, are you ready for another story? Oh, wait. Eh. brain sees as movement the total movement of an object's image of the retina minus the portion produced by active movement of the eyes. It does not subtract passive movement of the eyes. Okay, that's weird. Jose and the Bull. Jose Delgado, a particularly charismatic neuroscientist. Oh, by the way, this was written by John P.J. Pinal. Demonstrated to a group of newspaper reporters a remarkable new procedure for controlling aggression. Delgado strode into a Spanish bullring carrying only a red cape and a small radio transmitter. With the transmitter, he could activate a battery-powered stimulator that had previously been mounted on the horns of another inhabitant of the ring. As the raging bull charged, Delgado calmly activated the stimulator and sent a weak electrical current from the stimulator through an electrode that had been implanted in the caudate nucleus, a structure deep in the bull's brain. The bull immediately veered from its charge. After a few such interrupted charges, the bull stood tamely as Delgado swaggered about the ring. According to Delgado, this demonstration marked a significant scientific breakthrough. The discovery of a caudate taming center, and the fact that stimulation of the structure could eliminate aggressive behavior, even in bulls specially bred for their ferocity. To those present at this carefully orchestrated event, and to most millions who subsequently read about it, Delgado's conclusion was compelling. Surely, if caudate stimulation could stop the charge of a raging bull, the caudate must be a taming center. It was even suggested that caudate stimulation through implanted electrodes might be an effective treatment for human psychopaths. Alright, so I don't know if I'm pronouncing caudate right or not, or what it even means, but that's really interesting. Like, I never heard of that. I mean, I'm sure I read that in college. I mean, anyways, but I feel like that's not right. It's a bull's nature to be aggressive and charge into things. What's your thoughts on it, Tutor? Interesting, interesting. You just don't mess with the bull, you know? Analysis of the case 1. The fact of the matter is that Delgado's demonstration provided little or no support for his conclusion. It should have been obvious to anyone who did not get caught up in the provocative nature of Delgado's media event that there were numerous ways in which brain stimulation can abort a bull's charge, most of which are simpler and more direct and thus more probable than the one suggested by Delgado. For example, the stimulation may have simply rendered the bull confused, dizzy, nauseous, sleepy, or temporarily blind rather than non-aggressive, or the stimulation could have been painful. Clearly, any observation that can be interpreted in so many different ways provides little support for any one interpretation. When there are several possible interpretations for a behavioral observation, the rule is to give precedence to the simple one. The rule is called Morgan's Canon. The following comments of Wallenstein, 1973, provided a reasoned view of Delgado's demonstration. Well, the thing is, like I said, could have been so many different things. Also, I don't think it's humane to do that to an animal. But basically, the person said what they said. They're not sure if it's aggressive, blah, blah, blah. Case 2. Becky Moniz and prefrontal lobotomy. Ooh, getting into the good stuff, Tutor. In 1949, Dr. Igles Moniz, was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine for the development of prefrontal lobotomy. Okay, so they should not have gotten that award. A surgical procedure in which the connections between the prefrontal lobes and the rest of the brain are cut as a treatment for mental illness. The prefrontal lobes are the large areas left and right at the very front of the brain. Moniz discovery was based on a report that Becky, a chimpanzee that frequently became upset when she made errors during the performance of food-rewarded tasks, did not do so following the creation of a large bilateral lesion in an area of damage to both sides of the brain of her prefrontal lobes. After hearing about this isolated observation at a scientific meeting in 1935, Moniz persuaded neurosurgeon Almeida Lima to operate on a series of psychiatric patients. Lima cut out large cores of prefrontal tissue with a surgical device called a leucotomy. Following Moniz's claims that prefrontal surgery was therapeutically successful and had no significant side effects, there was rapid proliferation of various forms of prefrontal psychosurgery. One such variation was transorbital lobotomy.
That's when they go inside her eye. I know this. I watched Ratched.
Which was developed in Italy and then popularized in the United States by Walter Freeman in the late 1940s. It involved inserting an ice pick-like device under the eyelid, driving it through the orbit like the eye socket with a few taps of a mallet, and then pushing it into the frontal lobes where it was waved back and forth to sever the connections between prefrontal lobes and the rest of the brain. So, I know you're really high up there, but that's the transorbital one. In the analysis of case two, incredible as it may seem, Monet's program of psychosurgery, any brain surgery is such as prefrontal lobotomy performed for the treatment of psychological problem, was largely based on the observation of a single chimpanzee in a single situation. Thus, Monet's displayed a complete lack of appreciation for the diversity of brain and behavior, both within and between species. No program of psychosurgery should ever be initiated without a thorough assessment of the effects of surgery on a large sample of subjects from various non-human mammalian species. To do so, it's not only unwise, it is unethical. A second major weakness in the scientific case for prefrontal psychosurgery was the failure of Moniz and others to carefully evaluate the consequences of the surgery in the first patients to undergo and operate. The early reports that the operation was therapeutically successful were based on the impressions of the individuals who were the least objective. The physicians who had prescribed the surgery and their colleagues, patients were frequently judged as improved if they were more manageable, and little effort was made to evaluate more important aspects of their psychological adjustment or to document the existence of adverse side effects. Eventually, it became clear that prefrontal lobotomies were of little therapeutic benefit and that they produced a wide range of undesirable side effects such as amorality, lack of foresight, emotional unresponsiveness, epilepsy, and urinary incontinence. This led to the abandonment of prefrontal lobotomy in many parts of the world, but not before over 40,000 patients had been lobotomized in the United States alone. Still, prefrontal lobotomies continue to be performed in some countries. Some regard sound scientific methods as unnecessary obstacles in the paths of patients seeking treatment and therapists striving to provide it. However, the unforeseen consequences of prefrontal lobotomy should caution us against abandoning science for expediency. Only for observing the rules of science can scientists protect the public from bogus scientific claims. There is a somber postscript to this story. Moniz was shot by one of his patients. The bullet became lodged in his spine, rendering him paraplegic. Paralyzed below the waist. That's just crazy. Huh. Are you wanting another one? Okay, cool, me too. Are you sure you have time? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. So, the case of the man who fell out of bed. When he awoke, Dr. Sack's patient felt fine. That is until he touched the thing in the bed next to him. It was a severed human leg, all hairy and still warm. At first, the patient was confused. Then he figured it out. One of the nurses must have taken it from the autopsy department and put it in his bed as a joke. Some joke. It was disgusting. So he threw the leg out of the bed, but somehow he landed on the floor with it attached to him. The patient became agitated and desperate, and Dr. Sex tried to comfort him and help him back into the bed. Making one last effort to reduce the patient's confusion, Sex asked him where his left leg was. If the one attached to him wasn't it. Turning pale and looking like he was about to pass out, the patient replied that he had no idea where his own leg was. It had disappeared. Look at that fish brain. And rat brain, and cat brain, and chimpanzee brain, and then human brain. Dictomatous. Dicotomous. Dicotomous. See, this is why my tutor is supposed to be teaching me how to pronounce these things. A trait that occur in one form or the other, never in combination. For example, seed color is a dichotomous pea plant trait. Every pea plant has either brown seeds or white seeds. True breeding lines are breeding lines in which interbred members always produce offspring with the same trait. Example, brown breeds, brown seeds. Generation after generation. It's called the lizard, a case of Parkinson's disease. I've become a lizard, he began. A great lizard frozen in a dark, cold, strange world. His name was Roberto Garcia de Horta. He was a tall, thin man in his 60s, but like most of his patients with Parkinson's disease, he appeared to be much older than his actual age. Not many years before, he had been an active, vigorous businessman. Then it happened, not all at once, not suddenly, but slowly, subtly, insidiously. Now he turned like a piece of granite, walked in slow, shuffling steps, and spoke in a monotonous whisper. What had been his first symptom, a tremor? Had his tremor been disabling? No, he said. My hands shake worse when they are doing nothing at all. A symptom called tremor at rest. The other symptoms of Parkinson's disease are not quite so benign. They can change a vigorous man into a lizard. These include rigid muscles, a marked poverty of spontaneous movements, difficulty in starting to move, and slowness in executing voluntary movements once they've been initiated. The term reptilian stare is often used to describe the characteristic lack of blinking in the widely opened eyes gazing out of emotionless space, a set of features that seem more reptilian than human, truly a lizard in the eyes of the world. What was happening in Mr. De Orta's brain? A small group of nerves called the substantia nigra, which means black substance, were unaccountably dying. These neurons make a particular chemical neurotransmitter called dopamine, which they deliver to another part of the brain, known as the striatum. As the cells of the substantia nigra die, the amount of dopamine they can deliver goes down. The striatum helps control movement, and to that, normally it needs dopamine. Maybe that wasn't what I remembered. aren't you supposed to be like teaching me things instead of me teaching you things? I think really I'm your tutor. Did you know traumatic brain injuries can really cause someone to change? Can change their personalities completely? It's crazy. Purkinje effect. About eyes and how you see colors and stuff. Let's see. Ooh. Okay. There's gonna be words in here that I don't quite understand how to say. The case of Peter, the split brain patient tormented by conflict. At the age of 8, Peter began to suffer from complex partial seizures. Anti-epileptic medication was ineffective, and at 20 he received pimecetromide, which greatly improved his condition. It did not completely block his seizures. A sodium amytal test administered prior to surgery showed that he was his left hemisphere dominant for language. Following surgery, Peter, unlike most other split brain patients, was not able to respond with left side of his body to verbal input. When asked to make a whole body movement, stand like a boxer, movements of the left side of his body, touch your left ear with your left hand, he could not respond correctly. Apparently, his left hemisphere could not or would not control the left side of his body via ipsilateral fibers. During such tests, Peter, or more specifically, Peter's left hemisphere, often remarked that he hated the left side of his body. The independent, obstinate, and sometimes mischievous behavior of Peter's right hemisphere often caused him, his left hemisphere, considerable frustration. He, his left hemisphere, complained that his left hand would turn off television shows that he was enjoying, that his left leg would not always walk in the intended direction, and that his left arm would sometimes perform embarrassing, socially unacceptable acts, like striking a relative. In the laboratory, he, his left hemisphere, sometimes became angry with his left hand, swearing at it, striking it, and trying to force it with his right hand to do what he, his left hemisphere, wanted. In these cases, his left hand usually resisted his right hand, and kept performing as directed by his right hemisphere. In these instances, it was always clear that the right hemisphere was behaving with intent and understanding, and that the left hemisphere had no clue why the despised left hand was doing what it was doing. Interesting. Micro sleeps. Right. night. So you'll merely see that sleeping 8 hours per night is not the healthy ideal that it has been assumed to be. The fewest deaths occurred among people sleeping between 5 and 7 hours per night, far fewer than among those who slept 8 hours. Because these data are correlational, it is important not to interpret them casually. The researchers do not suggest that sleeping 8 or more hours a night cause health problems. This is just something about people who do so that leads them to die sooner than healthy people who sleep less. Although these studies do not prove that reducing your sleep will cause you to live longer, they do provide strong evidence that sleeping less than 8 hours is not a risk to one's health. And that's interesting. Mortality rate as a percentage of the rate for those who... Great. I'm in a really high mortality rate. This is not good. If you sleep 7 hours, you're at 100. Goodness gracious. Case of Jerry Corey, Xbox boxer. Jerry thumps his hard belly with both fists, smiles at the sound like a stone against a tree. "Feel it," he says proudly, punching himself again and again. He pounds big, gnarled fists into meaty palms, cocks his head, stares, vacant blue eyes, punch drunk at 50. Medical name, dementia, pugilistic, punch drunk syndrome. Cause, thousands of punches to the head. A top heavyweight contender in the 1960s and 70s, Corey now needs help shaving, showering, putting on shoes and socks, soon probably diapers. His older brother James cuts meat into little pieces so he won't choke. Jerry smiles like a kid, shuffles like an old man. Slow, slurred speech, random thoughts, snag on branches in a dying brain. Memories twisted, voices no one else hears.
That's so sad. Also, have you guys read the book Brain on Fire? I have, and I've also watched the movie. I think it's on Netflix. Girl has what's called encephalitis. An invasion of the brain by microorganisms is a brain infection, and the result is inflammation. Inflammation is encephalitis. So anyways. What do you think? You know, as a tutor, you should be the one, like, teaching me things, but I think I'm the one teaching you things. You're so, so tall. Ooh! Oh, it's not cracking. What is this? Anyways. I mean, if you like the situation, I guess you can let me know. Maybe we can meet again for another tutoring session or something. I don't know. But you are much taller, and I don't know if that bothers you or not. But thank you for being here. Okay, ta-ta, bye-bye.